Hello everybody. Today's video is about the secret code of DNA. All about how your body uses amino acids. This will answer your questions about what amino acids are, how do they get into your body in the first place, and how your body uses those amino acids to create your traits. Earlier this school year, we talked about different macromolecules that make up the human body. One of those four major molecules was called a protein. A protein is a type of macromolecule. And all macromolecules were called polymers because they had repeating units. A protein is a polymer. We could also call it a macromolecule. And the protein's repeated unit over and over again is called an amino acid. So if we were going to draw the repeating unit like beads on a string, each bead would be an amino acid. Eventually, before we could technically call this a protein, some other steps are going to have to occur. But right now, we'll just remember that an amino acid is the bead that makes up this polymer called a protein. Well, what actually do amino acids look like? Well, if you remember earlier in the year, we did an activity where we sorted different molecules based on their chemical structure. And some of you had cards with molecules that looked a little like this. And you were able to see that these molecules should all be placed in one category because their chemistry is very similar. What part of their chemistry is similar? Well, the way these images are drawn, you can tell that the top part of all of these are exactly the same. So there's this H3N with a positive charge bonded to a CH bonded to a COO with a negative charge. And you will see that in every single one of these 20 amino acids. So a protein is going to be made up of amino acids linked together. You could make an analogy that it's kind of like our alphabet is made up of 26 different letters linked together in different ways. Well, here we've got 20 letters in our alphabet to make the variety of proteins that the human body creates. However, unlike the alphabet, most proteins are going to be extremely long words. They're going to be made up of hundreds of amino acids. So it would be a very, very long word. So where does our body get the amino acids that it needs to build proteins? Well, a lot of them have to come from our diet. These amino acids that I have highlighted in yellow are considered essential amino acids. And you may have heard that on commercials or seen that on the side of a vitamin jar. And what that means is that these are amino acids that can only come from the food you eat. Foods that contain protein would have their own amino acid chains that your body is going to break apart and use those individual amino acids to make new proteins within your body. Well, these ones that are highlighted in yellow can only come from the food that we eat. They're essential. These other ones, your body is capable of assembling from other material within your body. So we call those non-essential amino acids. It's interesting to think about these essential amino acids and their role in world history. There is a book that I read in college called Guns, Germs, and Steel, and it talks about how germs in Europe are one of the main reasons that the Europeans were able to so easily conquer the New World. And why did Europeans have so many nasty germs? Well, it has to do with the amino acids that were available. The only items available in Europe to give people their essential amino acids came from the livestock that they ate, and hygiene was not very good at the time, and people often lived in the same houses as their livestock. They lived in the same really close vicinity. So they bred a lot of really dangerous germs in Europe. In the New World, there was the essential amino acids were found in these foods, and people did not need to have livestock, and so they never bred really dangerous germs that they could then pass to the European settlers. So world history is very much tied in to the idea of which amino acids are necessary in our diets. So how does your body actually use DNA to create a protein? Well, I have another video about protein synthesis that you can learn more detail about the process. This is just going to be a quick overview, and then we're going to talk about how to read the mRNA and figure out exactly which of those 20 amino acids is attached. So here's your DNA. We are going to construct a molecule called messenger RNA from that. It carries the message of the gene. This was a gene of DNA, a small segment of DNA. And the messenger RNA carries the message to the ribosome, and a codon, or a set of three nitrogen bases, is read one codon at a time. A tRNA will come in pair and drop off an amino acid. And then we slide the mRNA, and we're going to read a new codon and drop off yet another amino acid. So here this tRNA binds with that and drops off an amino acid. Well, what does this code actually mean? And which amino acids are actually being dropped off? Well, we will need a codon wheel to interpret that. So to actually read this secret code that's hidden in the DNA, scientists have figured out that each codon on the mRNA molecule is going to code for an individual amino acid. So for example, this first codon is AUG. We can use this tool that was created to help us figure out what the name of that amino acid is. So you always start at the center of the codon wheel and you work your way out. So in this case, because it's AUG, AUG. That means we are going to be attaching methanolamine. That is the first amino acid that is going to be attached in this amino acid sequence that we're going to be creating. Now, interestingly enough, every mRNA is going to start with methanolamine. They all start with AUG. It's called the start codon, and it tells, it's basically a signal within the cell to, okay, this is how we're going to start making an mRNA. So AUG is the start codon, and it codes for AUG, methanolamine. Okay, so the cell, the tRNA would bind and drop off the amino acid methanolamine. The mRNA then is slid down, and we read a new codon, AUU. Huh, okay, well, this tRNA will match UAA. But what amino acid is it carrying? Well, I look at the codon, AUU. This is called a codon wheel. So we're always reading it by the codon, not by the anticodon. That sometimes is a source of confusion for students. It's called a codon wheel, so we're reading the codon on the mRNA. AUU, AUU. So that means that this amino acid would be isoleucine. Drop off isoleucine. And we slide the mRNA, whoop, one more time. GUA is going to pair with CAU. And which amino acid must this be? Well, let's see, GUA, GUA. Valine would be this amino acid. And we would continue this process. This mRNA would be much longer than it is here in my picture. And the very last one is going to be a stop codon. So you can see here, it's going to either be, see here, there's a stop right here. It's a stop. And literally, that means stop. And that means it's the signal that says, we're no longer attaching amino acids. Stop. And that's going to be the end of the polypeptide that is created. So it's either going to be UAA is the ending one, or UAG will be the last codons. Here's another stop codon, UGA. So there's multiple ways that stop can be coded for, but that's a good way if the worksheet or test that you're working on is well written. Every mRNA strand should start with AUG, and it should end with a stop codon. And that tells you that you're done. If there's something coded, if the mRNA continues past stop, it's a trick question. And you should have stopped when it said stop. Okay? So what have we created in the end? We've created a chain of amino acids that we call a polypeptide. Another way to visualize it might be something like this. It wouldn't be as much of a pattern as this string of beads, but each bead would represent an amino acid. So this would be called a polypeptide. It's not called a protein until this twists. So it's going to have to twist up. And it has to do with the charges and the chemistry of the amino acids, how it's going to twist. And then it's also going to fold back up on itself, and it's going to come out with this kind of complex, folded, twisted structure. And then, erase these. So you have one complex, folded, twisted polypeptide, and then we have another complex, twisted polypeptide. And those are all, you actually end up with four. Now, these are just necklaces that I had made a long time ago. Really, they should all be made out of the same 20 beads, but this is just what I had available. So, when you have four polypeptide chains that have been twisted to their appropriate shapes and folded, they then attach to each other, and that, in the end, is what we call a protein. So proteins are very, very dependent on their shape. You can see the shape looks kind of like a mess to us, but the shape of the protein is really, really important in how that protein is going to function within your body. The shape has to be just perfect, because most of your body functions like a lock and key. And where the protein has to be perfectly shaped to interact with other molecules in your body. Some examples of that would include enzymes. They have to be perfectly shaped to be able to interact. Another very common example of what can go wrong when just one amino acid, so if just one of these was wrong, the protein would fold differently, and you can end up with a variety of different diseases are caused this way. Sickle cell anemia, where the blood cells are shaped like a half moon sickle shape instead of round, is caused by one amino acid different. Another one that is caused this way is Tay-Sachs disease. And with that, again, it's one amino acid, and in that case, the body's unable to break down fat in the brain, and the baby born with this will die at a very young age. And a third example of a disease that is caused by one amino acid being coded wrong and causing this entire protein to be folded wrong is cystic fibrosis. Cystic fibrosis is a disorder where the cells in the lungs are supposed to have a little tunnel in them that allows for ions to go through. Well, if the amino acid is wrong, that one right there, say this one, if it's wrong, this whole thing's going to fold wrong and it's not going to be a tunnel anymore. And so it's going to prevent things from flowing out of the cells and therefore out of the lungs and cause a lot of health problems for the individual. Later in the year, when you study genetics, you will find a lot more about how protein shape affects our traits. But these are some examples of how a misshapen protein can result in differences in a person's health. I hope you've enjoyed the video. Have a good day.